could not see our faculty here.
Sir, they are in attendees.
So because they have a class now up to 4:30, so they will be joining, right?
Yeah. So, sir.
Now it is 161. Okay, right. Yeah, number is increasing. Let us wait for 2-3 minutes so people will join. Yes, Dr. Rekha, now I think you can begin. Okay.
Yes, sir. Dear all, I, Dr. Rekha Vaghani, I am Event and PhD Program Coordinator, Assistant Professor. I welcome all of you in today's unique webinar, which is on innovative interdisciplinary approaches in understanding human behavior, which is being organized by IBAS as part of celebration of Innovation Day. The Innovation Day is celebrated on the occasion of the birthday of our beloved Chancellor, sir. I would like to introduce today our panel members. The moderator of today's webinar is Dr. Gautam Gavli, sir, who is the director and professor of MIT Institute of Behavioral and Allied Sciences. Sir has more than 30 years of experience in academics. Sir has served as the head of the department at Department of Psychology, University of Mumbai. Sir has represented many committees at various state and national level. Sir has authored 2 books and published many papers in journals of national and international repute. And another panelist of today and speaker of the webinar is Dr. Ishita Mandal. Ma'am is currently a practicing psychologist, a trainer, and also a guest faculty at various industries and reputed institutes of Mumbai, Maharashtra. She has successfully provided training in various organizations and industries on various topics. Ma'am has done her doctorate from University of Mumbai and completed her postdoc in psychology at University of Louisville, USA. Ma'am has participated in series of lectures on communication and personality on University of Louisville, USA. Ma'am has presented and published many papers in national and international journal. She has also co-authored a book. Now I would like to request our director, sir, to take over the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Rekha, madam.
Sir, you are muted, sir. Please unmute yourself. Sir, unmute yourself.
Okay. So, am I audible to all of you now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good afternoon to all of you. It's a very good occasion today. Whole MET groups, we are celebrating Innovative Day today, Innovation Day today. And this Innovation Day is celebrated on a very important occasion that our C6 sir, Chancellor 6 sir, Dr. Asim Chauhanji, we are celebrating his birthday today. And as a part of this function, MET University since last few years have been celebrating this as Innovation Day. I remember when I joined, and after 1 or 2 months, I had an opportunity to first time meet Dr. Asimji. And when I was formally introduced to him by our then Vice Chancellor, Dr. D.S. Rao, and immediately he asked me, "What is your plan, Dr. Gautam, what is your plan?" I said, "Sir, we would like to start 2 more specialization. That was my first interaction with our Honorable C6, sir. And immediately he accepted this idea. And with the discussion with my senior colleagues, we prepared the plan, submitted, and it was approved by Dr. Asimji. That's again part of innovative ideas. After listening in the morning, we had a very good function at our head office, which I attended. And there, our founder president and our chancellor, Dr. Asimji, they appreciated the role played by behavioral sciences as a innovative way to deal with community mental health. So as a part of this function, today we have one of the well-established counseling psychologists in Mumbai, Dr. Ishita. Dr. Ishita is also our visiting faculty. This year we invited her to accept our invitation to be visiting faculty. Dr. Ishita did her MA from Department of Applied Psychology, Mumbai University. She also did her PhD from Department of Applied Psychology and Counseling Center, Mumbai University. She did her postdoc from US, and she was, for many years, she was practicing in US. And she came back to Mumbai and she started her independent practice in Mumbai. She has established herself as a very competent counseling psychologist. So when I had a talk with her, say that we are celebrating this Innovation Day on 20th September, and we would like to have something very innovative in this particular field, and that too, interdisciplinarity in dealing with or understanding human behavior. So this is just a first attempt probably for her to deal with this particular topic, because many times we have been expertise in dealing with our own intervention strategies, where we get good feedback from the client, and we are likely to continue with this. Sometimes when you have to deal with diverse kind of this thing, clients having diverse background, and their eclectic approach is normally used to deal with their well-being. So Dr. Ishita accepted our invitation, and today she is with us. So without taking much of your time, we'll have 40-45 minutes discussion by her, and followed by 10, 15 minutes, maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes for question answer, and then I will conclude the session. So over to Dr. Ishita.
A very good evening to all of you, and thank you, Gavi sir, for giving me this opportunity to be on this platform. And as you rightly said, yes, this is a very different arena and a topic on which I would be talking. So for me too, it is being innovative to present it in the most innovative way to make it more interesting. So while I was working on this topic, since the time you said, there have been many ideas that I brainstormed with it. And every time I thought how differently I can present it, which would not only sound, yes, it's a little different, and yet at the same time, there is a touch of interdisciplinary in this area. Innovation, something when I relate innovation to behavior, I find that behavior is something which is very fluid. It's like, you know, it takes a shape of the situation, environment, circumstances that we are in. So it is more like people have always said, you know, being innovative is not something doing literally out of the box, but doing something within that box, but doing it a little differently. And that is an attempt that I made today to present my ideas to out on this platform and this topic of interdisciplinary approach to human understanding the human behavior. I'll share my PPT. Give me time. Sir, as you said, it is our Vice Chancellor birthday too. So from my end also, I convey my wishes to him. And what I would like to say is that dream the dream that has been within you forever. Be the child in your dream. Value the closeness. Play with life. Be the new in your own dream. Bridge the floods and build the peace. The world needs you and your dreams. Carry them forward. You are your dream. Claim and deliver them. Before I throw further light on understanding on this human behavior, it is important that we understand ourselves in everything that we do, we think, we say, we dream, we avoid, we embrace, we abandon, we express, we withhold the promises that we make, the gain, the loss, the things that we inherit. All of this is all within us. And it is important that we begin the journey in understanding ourselves. And as behavior therapist also has said, that behavior is learned interaction with our environment. And all behaviors are learned through various experiences, language, communication, environment that we live in, like the sociocognitive neurosciences, leading to whether it has been the economic, the market, the consumer behavior, the geography, the biology, the genetics. In every field, you'll find there is an element in which we make an attempt to understand the behavioral aspects or the reasons of what make a person behave. And people gain experiences from every little thing that they do. The beauty part is no one really knows the road that you have traveled other than you yourself. Yet today, I'll make an attempt to talk on this topic of interdisciplinary approaches in understanding the human behavior. So they say that behavior is hard, is behavior change is actually very hard. And it is hard to start, it is hard to sustain. This is what Kristen Berman said. And you'll realize that we have been dealing with certain behaviors that we have learned it right from our childhood till now. In order to bring about a change in those behaviors, it is not an easy thing for any individual to do so. Also, to make a first attempt to bring about a change because we need to, because the circumstances and the situation that we are in is important for us to change. We at least, we make an attempt to start, but even to make that attempt also takes a long time. It's hard to sustain it further because we can do it for 1 day, 2 days, but continuing it for a longer period of time, that becomes a practice and habit for us is not that easy. Say, take for example, the pandemic that we have been in. Mask is something that was told to us. What I noticed is by the time the unlock 4 set in, and if you walk down the street, you'll find people forget that they need to wear the mask. To make it as a habit, to live with masks, to move around with masks, to talk with masks, it has become a problem. What I have noticed with the, in the interaction of people when I have stepped out, people are, when they're walking alone, they're wearing the mask. But the moment they meet someone and they have to talk, that's when they remove the mask. So to sustain that behavior pattern that we need to continue wearing a mask, the change that we have sort of were forced upon us to accept it, to sustain that takes a long time. With all of this, we have had a wonderful experience in our everyday interaction that we have. And each and every experience is either beautiful, unknown, or pretty much mysterious. At least any experience that brings beauty and joy is wonderful and acceptable. We try and avoid that we destroy something. We do not want to destroy anything. We want to create something which is beautiful and joyous. Now, understanding this behavioral approach has also, a lot of it has been done and spoken through the economic model. The information campaign deals a lot of it, you will find. Where restaurants have the rating of the hygiene of the restaurants and the quality of the food. A lot of you have started, adapted to it, that when you want to go to a certain restaurant, it's something you take the review of it and based on which you make an attempt, you decide to go to a certain place to dine. You see how information campaign has also changed our behavior pattern. Socio-cognitive factors are always there, the cultural norms, the routines, the habits, the practices. And now is a social networking technology that has played a very major role in our life now. Even a decade back, technology had anyway seeped in. But if you see how 2020 has turned out to be, there has been a boom of technology. We all have been using the technology to interact. And even for today's program also, we have used the technology. If you have heard or seen the movie called Apollo 13, Hastings had once rented this movie. You know, those days you had the video for movies. He had rented this movie cassette, Apollo 13, and he sort of misplaced it. And 6 weeks later, he found this cassette. And he had to pay a heavy fee for it, and it was around $40. Now, this experience of his was very aggressive. And that led him to innovate something, motivate him to do something so that he can do away with the video cassettes, or rather the rental part of it. And he worked on it, and in 1997, Hashtag founded Netflix. And today in 2020, everyone is sort of hooked onto Netflix. Even when the movie theaters have closed down, Netflix saved a lot of people from not going to movie hall and yet watching their movies of their choice. So innovation is great, and it drives us to progress, to change, to facilitate growth, and also to make the world a better place that we live in. And that's always been an intention of human beings, to make the place a better place to live in. And one of the most visible and remarkable changes that all of us have seen in now is how our social relationships has brought about a little change. Physical face-to-face has now become virtual face-to-face. It has seeped into our family, where earlier, even if it was 10, 15 years back, it wasn't acceptable one to be connecting with someone always on the digital platform. But now families have accepted it, and they find it very convenient to connect with their family members, especially parents with children. Every minute of it becomes easier for them to connect. So the immediacy and the immediate reach to reach out to someone has also become much easier. 2020s, I saw people besides having these webinars and all, I've seen people holding Zoom parties, Zoom birthday celebrations. People have had various types of playing games has been, houses has been over the weekend, people play it on the Zoom. So people have tried to find ways of living their life, which was probably in 2019 in the physical format, on the digital platform. The way people have adapted and adjusted to the circumstances and the situation that we are living in. Now, this is where I call it as SNS, is social networking system. And social networking system is widely used by the millennials. Video calls have become another style of interacting, even with your far off distant relatives and friends. Connecting with them has become much easier, even if it is once in a way. So all these apps and technologies, you'll realize, has become extremely easy to make our life more comfortable. Lockdown time is what we all experienced. We were not allowed out. Shop, even if you did, shops were all closed. But everybody had their groceries, their stuff, food, and everything being delivered, and everything was done online. A lot of new businesses also got picked up, thanks to the technology that helped people to find ways of how to reinvent themselves differently, establish themselves differently, reach out to people differently. I saw a lot of people taking the initiative to help others in a society or in a community set up where they have started, that let's all order something together. It'll become easier to get things in bulk. It'll help the other person who is trying to get things for us. There has been a community social work a lot happening also, and it took a different shape. A lot of people came together on the WhatsApp group to not only which would only help them, but also help the other person who would be giving things to us. Now, from this end, when we go, you will think there is a flip side to it. This sounds very rosy, very good, all fun and all. There is the other side to it. There's psychosocial issues, like the domestic violence cases have also increased. Child abuse, substance abuse, internet addiction also has happened. At this point, I'd like to introduce a new term called as hikikomori. This term was coined by a Japanese psychiatrist, Saito. He spoke of social withdrawal and he termed this as a hikikomori. This is a little different from the psychiatric psychopathology that occurs, where an individual on his own confines himself in his room or in the house. So it is more like home confined lifestyle. He lacks the motivation maybe to do work, or if it is an adolescent, like going to school or college. So hikikomori is, hiki is pull and komori is to retire. Okay. Now, any system that we all function in, human being, we function within in a societal system. We have a family. So you'll realize the individual family and the society is all interdependent. We are all connected at the base, yet we have our own space to do things for ourselves. That is the ordinary system of our lifestyle. But hikikomori is where the individual has moved away from the base of being connected with the society and the family, and they just want to be in that state. Now, this hikikomori has seeped in a little bit in India too, where Indian millennials are also trying to shut themselves away for a few days with a tagline of enjoying the urban isolations. So behavior has a lot of meaning and a hope in the way we behave. And you'll find that any behavior that you do, there has to be a purpose behind it. Dr. Viktor Frankl, in his book, he wrote about a story of two prisoners, the Nazi camp time. The two prisoners were contemplating suicide because they had nothing to expect as such from life. But none of them committed suicide. Reason is because they found some meaning to live. And the meaning was, one of them, son was waiting for him to get released, while the other was a scientist. And he was working on a series of books which needed to be finished. So the decision we take is very crucial for further behaviors that we have. So your behavior has a component of psychological, the physical, the reflective, and the automatic mechanisms. All of them combined together is where you see the way you see yourself as. So as an individual, like I spoke in the hikikomori case, the individual moves away from the family and the society. So our behavior does have the material, the social, and individual factors influencing. Individual is, that's where I started, is you as an individual, knowing yourself, being aware of your own attitude, beliefs, your emotions, skills, even the social aspect talks of the networking, the institution, opinion leaders, and the material is the infrastructure, the objects, and so on. So behavior change through digital channel, it is happening for various reasons. One, in the current scenario we take, it is also through the digital channel, like through websites, smartphones, various apps that people pick it up. Like I said earlier, also communication plays a major role out here. To understand the behavior of an individual, the communication and his thinking patterns also make a difference. Individuals think automatically. And I'm sure all those who have studied psychology and therapy would agree with me on this front, that individuals think automatically. Now, whether you're thinking negatively or positively, that depends on the individual. But everyone thinks automatically. And the thought keeps pouring in. And based on what you have been thinking, how you have been interacting, what information you are gaining, your communication pattern also changes. So your communication pattern in your interaction with others, because human being a social animal, we interact with people. So your interaction with people, how you would communicate, is majorly based on either you being a combination of being assertive and cooperativeness. So when there is a high assertive and cooperativeness, there is high collaboration, a win-win situation. You know, it's one of the best things, but it is a little difficult for one to really practice this, having the skill, because assertiveness is definitely a skill, having the skill to work on being highly assertive, yet at the same time being cooperative. Those who are moderate assertive, but yet have a high cooperation, do compromise. And those who are low in assertiveness and low on cooperation are the ones who avoid. You see how the behavior pattern now keeps changing. Those who are high on assertiveness, but low on cooperation, have this competitive feeling. I want to win. I don't want to lose. And when they are low on assertiveness and high on cooperation, there is an accommodation aspect also. So, basic nature, whether it is your, you know, you are the way you're communicating, the way you're thinking, the best thing is to be kind and cooperative. You'll find another aspect I have noticed in the behavior aspect is people find ways to segregate their professional and personal life. So we have two set of people. One, those who keep their personal and professional life or their roles separate. That is, it does not, neither in the face-to-face interaction, they bring it up, nor it is flashed anywhere on the social media. And there is another group who are very happy to integrate both their personal and professional life. And you'll find the millennials, they tend to integrate. I don't know what the alpha generation would be doing. By then, there'll be probably some other concept that will come up other than segmenters and integrators. So the way we present our life, and I have noticed this with a lot of youngsters when they keep scrolling on, you know, whether it's on the Instagram, they are checking whether they are checking on YouTube or they are checking Facebook. They see people posting their pictures. Everyone says, wow, enjoying life, this and that. You know how some people, it affects them a lot. And they keep thinking how much this person is enjoying. I am not enjoying. How is this person enjoying the life? Why I cannot enjoy? Not necessarily what you see is what actually is happening. The real life could actually be in a very messy state. Yet, we present something in a different way. At this point, I'd like to bring in the culture theory out here, which I'll say is as the culture iceberg, cultural iceberg. One you will see is at the surface level, and other is at the deep culture level. Assume you had an appointment with someone, okay? And the person does not turn up on time. What would you say? Is it disrespectful or just a casual behavior? Each one of them will have a different response because that is based on your cultural iceberg. So every individual culturalized, we carry our cultural iceberg in our interaction. The way you're brought up, the child rearing practices, the religion, your decision making, your attitude towards how life is, the meaning of life, the way you come across in interacting with seniors or the senior citizens. Do you really live up to the role that you are expected to? Your idea of death or attitude towards death? What is your concept of about your own self, the past and the future? Do you find the world a safe place? Do you find the world is just or unjust? And what is the notion of leadership? Modesty, cleanliness, your mannerisms, and communication, as I just spoke earlier, the expressions, emotions, all of this is a deep culture. And at the surface level is what we get to see, which is at the tip of it. So you get to see you're enjoying good food. You get to see nowadays emojis help us to express in various ways without really writing down a one sentence or a one paragraph of the whole thing that you're experiencing it. Sometimes we express it through emojis. Sometimes we express it through music, the language. All of this is how individuals interpret the culture, their own culture and the culture in which they are living in. Sometimes you'll find certain behaviors strange. Sometimes it is acceptable and sometimes it is unacceptable. And there's also a cross-cultural conflict that can happen. And this cross-cultural conflict that happens not only because of the expectations that are not met, but mainly because, you know, somewhere deep down, it disturbs the individual at the emotional and subconscious level. Now, individual, when we are interacting with people when we are saying in a various ways we have gained enough knowledge, skills, and we are interacting with people in various ways, how our behavior pattern keeps changing. At this point, I'd like to throw some light on the mind aspect of it. And being a psychologist, we cannot not talk about mind. Mind somewhere seeps in somewhere or the other. So the mind, Howard Gardner, he spoke about 5 types of mind. He threw light on the disciplined mind, the synthesizing mind, the creating mind, the respectful mind, and the ethical mind. The disciplined mind is more of where it is the special, your talent, where it lies. The synthesizing mind is someone who is who takes information, they process it, and the systematic way that they function. The creating mind are the ones who love to break the ground rules. And you'll find those are the people who will bring about a lot of changes in the business also. They often try to break ground rules. And the respectful mind are the ones who have learned the importance of respecting others right from their parents, schools, teachers. And the ethical mind loves to do community work in a most ethical way, regardless of the relationship that they may have with the other person. That's where we talk further on. This is this part of it is most interesting for me. When we are talking of the interdisciplinary aspect of understanding the human behavior. Every human behavior, one I spoke of the cultural iceberg. The other is this, you need to have the software, the hardware, and the operating system. That is the psychology, the sociology, and the culture. The amalgamation of all of this leads to growth and innovation. You see for yourself, whenever you try and you behave in a some way, look into your own hardware, software, and your operating system. Every individual has a meaning behind functioning in a certain way. And they could be driven by any of them more dominantly. It's always good to have a balance of your software, hardware, and operating system. But sometimes one of the areas could be more dominating than the other areas. That's where we individuals are unique. We all of us do not follow the same system pattern. And that's where I spoke about the mind part of it. So depending on the type of mind that you have, maybe the way you churn out your software, hardware, and operating system would be different. So for every individual, your development, the ideas that you have, the inspiration, you could be gaining inspiration from others, or you could be inspiring others. The creativity, people often understand creative means you have to be an artist, not necessarily. Creative also means trying to do something differently within the limited resources that is available to you. And how do you behave and what decisions do you take at that time reflects in your behavior. So what you learn, your creativity, the ideas that you have, how do you churn out those ideas? Your development, inspirations, all of this, when churned out well, that's what we call as the behavior part of it. So every behavior, like I said, would have two major forces, the social forces and the individual forces. I try to bring about a little, made an attempt to bring a change a little way of understanding and looking at ideas as behaviors. And being a therapist, I had to bring this up front. I'm sorry for all the tests we have given, haven't shown anything. I will have to treat you for symptom deficit disorder. I had to bring it up as a therapist. So for all of you, I'm sure you all probably do not show any disorder in any form, because you all are aware of your software, hardware, and your operating system, and you know how you can help yourself. At the same time, when we are talking of the interdisciplinary approaches to understanding of the human behavior, is also how we individuals, when we are operating from different systems, how we try to synthesize the information that we receive, blending it well with the logical aspects within the cultural system that we operate, and trying to objectively understand, objectively and holistically understand the behaviors. Thank you for your patient listening. I always say, being on the technology digital platform. Being on the digital platform, the advantage that we have is you get the most attentive audience, which otherwise you don't get to see it when it is on a face-to-face, in a physical classroom. You'll find someone moving around, someone looking here. And while you're on the other side of the table, you see so many different behaviors. Somebody's scribbling, somebody's checking on their cell phones, somebody's talking. Suddenly you realize the LCD is not working, or somebody's opening the door, walking in. Whether people who are sitting and listening or as speakers, there's always an element of distraction. And once you're done with it, if you sit back and think, you'll wonder, what made people behave that way? Why couldn't they be listening? What was something that someone was talking so much? These questions don't arise when you're on the digital platform. Other than, and if all have muted themselves, is one of the most attentive audience that one can ever get in life, I think. Thank you, all of you. And thank you, sir.
Thank you. Right. Dr. Rekha, would you like to take some questions here?
Yeah, actually, thank you, ma'am. And this is actually, I got a new perspective today to understand human behavior, and it was really a unique way through which psychology students and also even teachers can really understand the behavior using many disciplines which we are actually, studying. So thank you. A whole new perspective came in today. Thank you, ma'am. So now the session is open for some of the questions. So since our audience are on mute, so they can post their questions on there are question answer even tab which is open even on chat section. So ma'am, there are questions I would like to take. So Ojaspita is asking, is it wise to be an integrator and mix different relations of life?
There's nothing right or wrong in that. It is one chooses to be an integrator or one chooses to be a segmenter, because based on which you decide how you will display your behavior as. You don't, it is individual's choice that you make. So I would say you are the choice architect of your own behavior. So you choose what you would like to do. And every whether it's a segmenter or a integrator, there's always a flip side to it. as much as advantages that you will have, there will be a flip side to it. Now it is up to you whether you ignore the flip side and move ahead with what you know, there must be a reason. There is definitely a strong reason for you to be one of them, either an integrator or segment. There's a strong reason for it. And if you're comfortable with that reason, that's perfectly okay.
There are other questions too. So by Ojaskita itself, one question I'm again taking, she has posted 3-4 questions. So people who have stubborn political values, do they have disciplined mind or synthesized mind?
Those who have
stubborn political values. She's asking the people who have stubborn political values. So do they have disciplined mind, as you were, you know, referring a different kind of mind, and synthesized mind? That's what she's asking, ma'am.
A lot depends on whether you are viewing stubborn in a negative way or a positive way. Because I always look at stubbornness in a very positive way, because stubbornness helps you to achieve what you wish to achieve. So how do you bring in a lot of information and you believe and you hold on to those information to an extent that you think that it is extremely required. It is reasonable enough. So based on which you would definitely function. So if you're looking stubbornness in a negative way, then obviously then stubbornness, it does not really come under the disciplined mind. But a lot depends on how you have perceived the stubbornness as a goal-oriented achieving something.
Yeah, that's true, ma'am. So, ma'am, another question by Varun is, how to develop your creative mind? What are the ways to develop our creative mind?
As I said earlier, creativity is not something looking outside the box. Creativity is something looking within. So if you have to really be creative, you have also to know who you are. To understand your own self, get into the cultural iceberg of understanding yourself better. So if you're aware of your own strengths and abilities, I'm sure you have the willingness to take a step to move ahead. And only when you take a willingness to step ahead, you will see magic happening. And that magic is nothing but creativity or being creative.
Yeah, ma'am, actually, that's a good point. The takeaway from the session is looking within to be more creative.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, ma'am, next question is by Jay Pandit. With the rising digitalization and amid pandemic, the scenario is this, psychologists are not able to interact and counsel their patients effectively. So, panelists, my question is, how important is the rise of virtual psychology and the virtual psychologist today?
Personally speaking, I would anytime like to do a face-to-face physical counseling sessions with my clients. But considering the circumstances and the situations that we are in, we can't say, we can't help you if you need help. So that's when the virtual counseling or the digital counseling sets in, and there are a lot of people who probably are not from the same city and from elsewhere, they would like to. But for the timing, to help someone on the virtual platform is perfectly okay if someone is comfortable. But if you ask me, I find that a lot of things that I miss out on a virtual platform while I'm dealing with my clients, which I find it is much easier, much convenient. You are able to observe your client. You're able to gauge your client. Your clients are finding it more comfortable and they're more focused. I find they being focused is more when they are in a physical setup, in a clinic setup, when they are. In a digital platform, I find I have seen my clients moving from one room to another room. They start doing something while they're in a session. Sometimes they forget because, you know, you are in a home setup. Is work from home sometimes. So you are doing all types of work. So being focused and being serious for what you are in for at that time, that attention gets diverted and for various reasons. So if the need arises, psychologists need to reach out to people and do digital counseling. My personal experience is I would anytime, once the situation is back to where I can be doing face-to-face counseling in my clinic setup, I would like to do that, get back to that setup.
Yeah.
And not be in a mask and a face shield with my client as if I'm in a war with my client. I don't want that.
Yeah, and ma'am, sometime in the same setting, we are more subjective because we are in the same setting, and in counseling, we get a more objective setting even to view our own self. So I think that part is somewhere missing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, ma'am. So ma'am, next question is that at what point does the interaction through social media during the pandemic become harmful for us psychologically? And also, how do you think society will be integrate itself socially back into face-to-face interaction once the vaccine comes out?
People are waiting for to get into a face-to-face interaction because how much ever I've seen the rise in enjoying the interaction on a digital platform was very high in March, April, May. Whether it is with your family members, whether it is picking up long-lost friends, whether it is connecting with friends who are not even within your city, wherever it is. But the dip started in from June onwards. And by July and August, I find people are saying, that's it. I need to step out. I need to interact and I need to see people physically. I need to make an attempt to go somewhere, sit somewhere. Somewhere the environment in which you are catching up with your friends, socializing with your people makes a lot of a difference. So yeah. I feel people are waiting to get back to normalcy because all of them have got bored. The boredom has in some way or the other set in. How much will you be doing same thing when you're doing work from home? A certain corner in your house becomes a work from this time to this time. Then it is like a movie shooting going on. Your home is like a studio. Then again, the placement changes. That same place now is used for some other purpose. People around them are all the same. Nothing is changing. Then again, sometime later, you are again moving into another corner of the room for some other purpose. So it is like playing games within your own house. We're changing the setting here and there. This is somewhere is probably upsetting people or rather getting bored. Yet at the same time, I will say people are also getting a little anxious. And what is now seen as the COVID stress syndrome is setting in. People are also getting anxious about what would happen. So yes, let's be very positive about it, that when the vaccine comes in, people, however, would be a little cautious, but I think they're all waiting to get back to their normal life. They'll probably value 2019 more than they ever did before in life.
Yeah, ma'am, there are lots of questions, but I think I'll take only one question since we are running out of time. Two questions probably. So ma'am, there's a new term which Pallavi Mishra is asking that she has introduced a new term that do you think human behavior is different within digital sociology and physical sociology?
Digital sociology.
She's saying that how do you think that human behavior is different in these two? So digital sociology, now we are celebrating birthdays even online, and everything is happening online due to this COVID. So there's a new form of social interaction is coming up. So she's asking how these two are different and probably.
One is the digital, other one is?
Physical, where we are interacting the previous one.
That is conventional. Yes, and that is what I said earlier, that people try to show not always their real self, but they show differently. It is a choice that they make, that they show differently when they are in the digital platform than when they are face to face, because they know in the digital platform a lot of more people would be seeing and understanding them. They find that that emotional connect really doesn't happen on a digital platform as much as it happens in a physical interaction.
Yeah.
So behavior pattern slightly is different on the digital platform. I would say simply take the example of those who post their pictures in the Instagram. Umpteen filters are used. And if you see that person face to face, the person may or may not really resemble or could be very different from the impression that you had the person seeing in the pictures and what you see. So we always make attempts to bring use filters in our life to present it in the best possible way, because for all you know, the person's real life could be in a mess, or the person could be having some turmoil somewhere. By presenting things differently and in beautiful way on a digital platform may give that individual some solace, some happiness, and another positive way of looking at life.
So ma'am, there are more questions. I'll post it to you, but now I'll take last question. So Abhishek is asking, ma'am, you are also a behavioral trainer in corporate world as well. I would like to know, how has this recent pandemic and its allied situation managed to disturb the corporal training? And also, what the new and innovative ways that you are using in corporate training or workshops?
Oh, everything has become digital now. Even workshops have become digital. And when I started with digital workshops, it was a very different experience, because I am on video while others are not. So I am talking to a faceless screen. Only thing is that I get to hear their voices. So normally in physical setup, when we do the workshop or the training program, there are a lot of activities designed that they do. There's a lot of group activities going on. You approach every table. There's a lot more of discussion happening. This element of it gets missed out in a digital workshop. So the whole designing program has changed now, which would suit to be on a digital platform. Yes, the experience is very different. So I had to be a little more creative how to make a training program. Have those training programs in designing the activities in such a way that engagement of employees can also happen, yet the message can be conveyed.
Yeah, I think more than enough now. Questions are more than enough. Okay, so since she's our visiting faculty, some of our students can interact with her later also. And I think, over to Dr. Rekha. Should I conclude this now?
Sir, please go ahead with conclusion.
Thank you. So it was really nice to have Dr. Ishita today with us on this Innovation Day. And she tried her level best to provide different innovative approaches to understand human behavior. In addition to what Dr. Ishita expressed in her presentation for 30-35 minutes, and the kind of question which our students and I think faculty also raised, some of the questions he answered in a very appropriate manner. Now see, understanding human behavior and multidisciplinarity, that's something which originated in Canadian culture, which we call it multiculturalism. And we expect that, even if you see the literature, we'll find sociologists have contributed a lot in understanding human behavior initially. Then psychology started working on it. Now, in this particular situation, the question which were directed towards this pandemic and effect of this pandemic on the understanding of human behavior, all of us, we have been raising questions that we need to have online counseling sessions, what you call e-therapy nowadays, e-therapy, or what Dr. Ishita very rightly pointed out that she will, and then many of us, those who are involved in actually counseling the clients, we really wanted to have face-to-face interaction with our client, because we always believe that emotions and feeling cannot be understood through distance. This is what we have been taught by our forefathers in psychology. Okay, I may be using wrong term, maybe gender biased term. I'm calling forefathers, but this is just to make you understand. Because see, during pandemic and the kind of terminologies which are being practiced that social distancing. Some people have objected for this social distancing. People say that it should be called physical distancing and not social distancing. Because in social distancing, what happened in a multicultural society like ours, there's a possibility of othering the people, like othering. Thinking that, and then that othering will have a different impact on psychosocial behavior of individuals. So that social distancing is a risky term, which we use. On the contrary, that we need to have solidarity when you talk in terms of community psychology. Because see, normally when you have to deal with society like one side, we claim our society as collectivistic society. But actual behavior during this pandemic is becoming individualistic, right? Yeah. So people are thinking that, I mean, I must protect myself and my family. Now, this is something, these new norms are coming. And this is just because of this pandemic has forced people to think this way. So there is a risk consequences. Like, see, if you find any psychological intervention when it entered in or comes in existence in a very conflicting situation, like in a war situation or like say now a pandemic situation, has become new norms nowadays that online learning, online teaching. Of course, I mean, psychology, it is not completely possible to have online learning, online teaching or counseling, where there's a possibility of othering the people, like, see, and that is a very risky thing for a country like ours, society like ours. The another very important aspect, because if you see in interdisciplinarity, sociologists have contributed, economists have contributed, like, see, we came, now we are talking about more of behavioral economics, how it contributes to understand human behavior collectively, not necessarily individual behavior per se, but collectively. And that's why that also approach needs to be understood by psychologists. So political scientist approach, sociologist approach, even economist approach, and approach, of course, from physiology and biology, that approaches are already there in, and then Dr. Ishita referred some of the approaches there. Okay, so these interdisciplinarity we need to look into. And then there are like spirituality again, because that's also equally important aspect. Like if you go to Sri Lanka, Colombo, they have their own way of healing practices. Japanese have different healing practices. In India, we have our own healing practices. I think this needs to be considered as a supportive mechanism to understand the human behavior. Of course, I mean, these are some of the things needs to be validated in Indian situation, even in other situation also. Like, see, there are many things, like, see, interventions are there in our society through cultural aspect, sometimes religious aspect. Okay, and there I think we need to identify some of the intervention strategy and add it as a supportive mechanism to understand human behavior or correct human behavior. Like, see, we have many festivals, we have many occasions where we come together, we have a dancing, drumming, you know, we have this another like vision quest. So these are some of the different approaches that we need to understand and incorporate in understanding human behavior. I think that's also equally important, and this is a now demand that, I mean, there are many, like, say, for example, in our Eastern culture, we have this like an icon therapy. An icon therapy is just to express gratitude. Like, see, way somebody has done something, and then we express our gratitude in a process that, I mean, that person who is whom we are expressing gratitude to us, that person is benefited. But at the same time, when you express our emotions and feeling in the form of gratitude, I think that also helps us to maintain our own well-being. So this is some, like, see, we call it Nikon therapy in Japanese Buddhist approach to deal with human behavior. I think there are many such interdisciplinary approaches, and even Dr. Ishita, the conflict management, and some of you have raised some question that whether accommodative or compromising or soothing, whatever, that there are different kind of conflict management strategies. So which is appropriate? I mean, that's why more of a confronting kind of things is more appropriate. That one side, one should be high on relationship at the same, high on your achievement also. Like relationship, achievement can go together. So confrontation kind of things. Confrontation is a very positive terminology. You should be able to confront. Okay. Some of you have raised very interesting questions, creativity, you know, creative mind. You know, and we talk in terms of like reflective thinking, what Dr. Ishita was referring about. And if you remember that John Dewey's contribution of reflective thinking, that is something very, 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 very interesting. And because of this, when John Dewey was a professor in Columbia University, and then because of his contribution in reflective thinking, now he became president of APA, American Psychological Association. So that kind of reflective thinking, that's also something very interesting, because while confronting ideas, like even in our new educational policy, Government of India very categorically stated thinking, creative thinking, critical thinking. Now, this is something very interesting, because our growth is dependent upon this. And that's why our children should be able to critically analyze each and everything. This is what I mean, I could see in the new educational policy. Okay, I think, and then there are many things which yesterday we were discussing with our students also, and students have contributed a lot. And there is a recognition for psychological services in national educational policy. Okay, even career guidance and counseling, something which is very interesting particularly for the field of psychology and mental well-being. And there, I think, as an academic institute, we need to come out with interdisciplinary approach to understand human behavior. Okay, so I think then our relevance to society will definitely increase, and this is what our focus is on. So thank you very much. It's a really wonderful discussion. Dr. Ishita has given full justice to this particular topic. And we will start, because this is our small way. It's an innovative idea to think about other disciplines. And let us recognize what others have contributed for the psychology as a discipline. Because if you see, when I purposefully use the term forefathers of psychology, but many times people call psychology as a fatherless discipline. So it is contributed. There are many, many people have contributed to psychology to grow. So with this, I think over to Dr. Rekha.
So thank you so much. And the participants really, they asked such good questions that made me realize that really there are challenges which we are facing, and this session can really help us to, you know, overcome those challenges. Probably it can add knowledge into that. So I would like to thank our director, sir, for giving me this opportunity to organize this webinar. And also I would like to heartily thanks to our today's speaker, Dr. Ishita Mandal, for accepting our invitation and delivering talk on such a valuable topic. I also would like to thank all IBAS team members for their support. And obviously this webinar is not complete without our IBAS students, and without thanking them who participated actively in this webinar. I would like to thank our IT team and head office for providing support and providing this platform for webinar. Now I would like to request Director Sir to announce the session adjourned.
Okay. Thank you. Session is closed. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, all of you.
Thank you.